this morning. My prayer for you this morning is that this statement would catch your heart. This is a statement: He is risen. He is alive. I pictured myself, and I only pictured it because I will obviously wait for the Holy Spirit to do something. But I pictured myself running around the building shouting, "He's alive," just so that you would hit your spirit. Because if we never catch that fact that He is alive, we miss the gospel. If we never catch it in our hearts that He's alive, we miss everything that He has for us. It's the only religion, the only religion, in which the God is alive. Simple as that. So stand back, not too close. Just wait till I start running, then you have to worry, follow me, yeah? It's the only religion in which He's alive. And we should be shouting it from the mountaintops that He's alive, He's risen, there's no other one like Him, He's extraordinarily, supernaturally beautiful. And He's alive and He wants to dwell with you and with me this morning. He wants to take us on incredible adventures. He's not dead. He's not in the ground. He's not a set of rules and regulations. He's alive. He's active. He's present. He wants to be with us. He has extraordinary adventures. You read the Word of God and how Jesus raised the dead, cleansed the lepers, opened the prison doors as the disciples sang in prisons and the prisons opened. You think those are adventures? I think God's got far much more for us here in 2000 that we haven't even tapped into yet. That the world once again needs to begin to see that there is an alive God who is present, who has miracles upon miracles available to those who would ask and seek. And when we begin as sons and daughters to ask and seek and begin to display the very power that raised Jesus from the dead here on earth, I believe that the world will turn. Because that's what happened when Jesus walked here on earth. As He walked, as He dwelt, as He discipled, as He interacted with people, as He sat down at supper, as He walked past the synagogue, as He, wherever He went, the very power of God went with Him. And we've got into this very boring idea of what Christianity is about. Sorry, must I release the children? Can I release the children? Children, hang on, you're released. Before I get into excitement, yeah. The children are released. There's a children's church at the back there with Auntie Michaela. No. There's a place of honor. I've learned from young. Sure. Do you need some more marshmallows here, Amy and Michaela? You sure? I've got plenty in front. Okay. But let me get back to that excitement that Jesus is alive. He wants to dwell here. He wants His glory to be manifest here. He wants to show you and me what life is truly like. And it's not found in a set of rules and regulations. It's not found in a religion. It's found in a relationship with a live Jesus who is no longer in the grave, who is not just seated in heavenly places, but He's come down to dwell with us. Here present. And we're worried about what tomorrow's going to bring. I want to tell you, let's be consumed with all that Jesus is. Let's be consumed with all that He is, because He's far more than a set of rules and regulations. He's far more than just attending church on a Sunday. It's far more than just being with you at your work from Monday through to Friday and just making you cope and get through. There's far more to Jesus than what we realize. So I want to share a very exciting story with you this morning. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 28. Why are you turning there? Heaven. Share them with my friends. Desmond. Share them with the friends while they're all finding Matthew chapter 28. This morning I've entitled my sermon, The Last Three Words of Jesus and the First Three Words of Heaven. See, it's going to get I don't know if there's enough. Husbands and wives can take a bite from each end. What? Can't we have fun around here? Okay. I've learned to have fun in church. Jesus is fun. Wherever he went, he turned water into wine. He had a party. I share some Easter eggs. Those that are still fasting, please don't take any. So the last three words of Jesus as he hung on the cross in Matthew chapter 27 were these words, tetelestai, which means it is finished. What was finished that day? And my dad prayed it this morning as he shared with you. The work of salvation is finished. Past tense, done, finished. God's work has been completed. And what has been completed is the fact that you and I can once again have a relationship with the living God. The work has been done. There is nothing more that you or I can do. He has taken away our shame. He's taken away our debt. He's taken away our sickness. He's taken away our disease. The work of salvation is 100% complete, as Jesus hung on the cross there and said, "It is finished." And what is the saddest part of life is the potential that we never live in that which Jesus did on the cross, but that we live in a constant place of wanting to fulfill that which was already done. Let me say that again. The saddest part of life is that we potentially live still in a place of wanting to do the thing that Jesus already has done on the cross. And that was complete the work of salvation. There's nothing more that you and I can do. Thank you, Jesus, for that. There's nothing you or I can add to it. There's nothing on you that I can take away from it. The work of salvation is 100% complete. Jesus, as he hung there on the cross and said it was finished, and his spirit went to go make proclamation in Sheol and say to the enemy, that day that you have not been waiting for is finally here, and made proclamation there and said, I've come back to take the keys of death and life. That work was completed. And you and I have a privilege of accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. And as we do that, we step into that completed work of salvation. There's nothing you and I can do. We can't help the granny across the street. We can't go and feed the poor more to go and earn salvation. The work of salvation is complete. And we need to live in that space. But in Matthew chapter 28, we're going to read this incredible story that we find about the third day. You excited out there? Anyone outside excited with me? He's alive. And I'm excited. Matthew chapter 28, verse 1. It says, now after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. An angel of the Lord on this third day, this incredible day that we're going to see take place in history, there's this angel that descends from heaven, comes and rolls back the stone, and then decides, no, I'm just going to sit on this and wait and see what's going to take place here on earth. This angel was incredible, excited. He wanted to see what was going to happen. He was going to see what was going to take place on this day. And so he just decided to sit and wait. Is that what your word says? Just checking what your word says. That my word ties up with your word, eh? I can see, Lucas, you're checking it. It says he sat and waited, eh? Just says he sat. And his countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And then it says, and the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. I can understand if I was those soldiers, I would probably be the same. Can you imagine just sitting in a place? Remember, these guards, highly trained, highly skilled, appointed by Pontius Pilate to keep guard of this tomb where Jesus had been laid. Because remember, the whole thing was, if Jesus rose from the dead, there'd be a problem in that area. So Pontius Pilate wanted to make sure that Jesus' body wasn't stolen out of the grave. Okay, you with me? And so he put two highly skilled, highly trained guards who probably were not fearful of anything. Probably a little bit like Lucas and Tony, 6'7", strapping young men. Back in the day, okay. And these guards stood on either side of the tomb, and then imagine being them on that day. Suddenly from heaven descends an angel with bright lightning, clothes as white, radiant, and just walks in on the scene, and the very stone that they're guarding happens just to, remember, it wasn't a light-weighted stone as well, okay? A couple of thousands, probably kilograms. What's 2,000 pounds, 3,000 pounds? 2 tons, there we go. I don't think any one of us right here could pick up 2 tons. Anyone can pick up 2 tons around here? Okay, wonderful. Because I can't. And descends here, this angel comes in on the scene, rolls back the stone, and sits on it. And I can imagine the angel just sitting down and having a look at these two. Gang, you thought the stone was immovable. You thought that you could keep Jesus' body in the tomb by sitting on the side and guarding this. And they became like dead men. I think to some degree I would probably be the same. You know, anyone encountered an angel recently? It says they became like dead men. And the scene unfolds before their eyes. And remember now, I better not shame some men here, but anyway. And the guards shook for fear of him and became like dead men. And remember, in on this scene walks Mary and Mary. Now, if you were Mary and Mary, what would you think? You've come to the very place in which they've laid your Savior's body behind a 2-ton stone, guarded by two men who are now dead, appearing dead on the floor. There's an angel sitting on a stone, and you walk in on this scene. I think the very next words that come from heaven are very apt and very appropriate, because these are the very first words that come from heaven after Jesus had spoken, "It is finished," tetelestai. And let me say what happened that moment is that the angel declares these words from heaven, "Do not be afraid." And if you go and read through Scripture, there's a few moments that those kind of words get declared. And this is what I want to say to you. If you've never encountered God in such a way that you've become afraid, it's time to ask God for that encounter. Let me say it again. If you've never had an encounter with the God that makes you become afraid, it's time to ask for an encounter, because either we can walk in this lukewarmness or in this coldness of just a religion and this, I'm doing the things that God has called me to do, or I can walk in an encounter with him. And Mary and Mary had an encounter that day as they walked in on the scene, two guys who are strapping young men guarding the tomb as dead. angel sitting on the stone. And out of the angel's mouth come these words, first words from heaven. Do not be afraid. I was going to paraphrase it, but I better not. Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. And it's important to grab hold of those words as well, because we need to understand that Jesus was crucified. He was dead and buried. Okay? It's one of the foundations of Christianity that we need to make sure that he's secure and we understand that. And here are the words that I want you to grab hold of this morning. He's not here. He is risen. He's not here. He is risen. As he said, and here's the invitation that has already been extended to you this morning. Come and see. Come and see where he lay. And there's this incredible picture, and we read it just as, you know, as we read it as text. But imagine being Mary and Mary that day. I don't know in your household, but I've seen this happen quite a few times. It's often the ladies that come and check the stuff. You agree with you, Robert? Eh? And it's often in those scary situations that the women are doing the stuff, eh? But picture this with me this morning. Angel sitting on a rock, just waiting to see what's going to unfold in the day. His clothes is lightning, bright, shining. Two guards who are strapping, lying dead on the floor, as dead. And Mary come in, and the angel's words, do not be afraid, for I know you've come to seek the Savior. He is not here. He is risen. Come and look where he lay. And I want to extend that invitation to you this morning. He is not in the tomb anymore. He is risen. Come and check it out for yourself. Don't take it my word. Don't take your friend's word. Don't take, maybe you're visiting from another church, don't take your pastor's word. Come and see for yourself. Come and have an encounter with God that causes you to tremble and fall with your face on the floor like those soldiers as dead. Because it's from that place, it's from that encounter that I believe Mary and Mary, as they came back, there was an excitement in their heart to share the risen Savior of the world has done what he said he would do. He's alive. Out of our encounters with God comes the excitement in our heart to go and tell the world, my Savior is alive. He's not dead. He's doing everything he said he would. That's got to excite us. That's got to cause us to run around the building shouting, he's alive. So what are some of the things that we can learn from the story? Okay, let me finish the story. He's not here. He's risen. As he said, come see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And indeed, he's going before you into Galilee, that you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear, because they were still fearful of what they've just seen. I think I would have been too. I'm sure you would have been too. No, you guys all. Okay, wonderful. With fear and great joy, and ran to bring the disciples word. So what are some of the things that we can learn from this incredible story, this incredible day? The number one thing that I want to share with you is he is risen. That's the thing we've got to grab hold of. As he hung there on the cross and he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished." There are a couple of things that took place on that moment and in this moment that we read. Number one, the curtain was torn from top to bottom. Not to let us into the Holy of Holies, but to let the Holy of Holies out in the world. Come on. It happened a couple of days after today, where the Holy Spirit was released. It was the Holy of Holies. Remember, up until that point where Jesus hung on the cross, only one person once a year could enter into the Holy of Holies. But from that moment, from that time where Jesus says, "It is finished," and the veil was torn from top to bottom, not that any man could have done it, because it wasn't torn from bottom up, it was torn from the top down. It was because God wanted to let his people in on what he was busy doing. And he wanted to let his glory out. Part of number one, as he was risen, the stone wasn't rolled to let Jesus out. Jesus could have walked through the stone. As we saw in a little bit later, as he met with his disciples, the disciples were fearful in the upper room, doors shut, windows barricaded, and in walked Jesus. So he didn't need the stone to be removed in order to walk out. The stone was removed so that you and I could walk in and see that he's no longer there, he's risen. One of the other things that we need to grab hold of is, and I believe this is part of number one, that he's risen, is once Jesus said it was finished, darkness descended on the earth. As the Father had turned his back on Jesus, I believe he allowed the darkness to descend so that people couldn't see the state that his son was in and what was taking place. And I want to say that probably over the last 2 years, darkness has descended on earth, but we're on day three. Come on. Darkness has descended on earth, where we've got despondent, and maybe you one of those, where you've got despondent, where you're in despair. And remember the disciples and all those that had believed in Jesus as they saw him hang on the cross as he died, dead. Important to grab hold of that. He is dead. And the Christians, or those days who believed in Jesus and believed what he had done, must have been despondent, must have gone into despair, must have gone into a place of fear, going, "What on earth is going on here?" And I believe if you look over the last 2 years, darkness has descended on earth, and these disciples, who are you and me, the sons and daughters, have probably gone, "What on earth is going on here?" And for some of us, we've got despondent. We've gone into despair. We've lost some things, as those people did on that day. They lost the Savior of the world who hung on the cross. I want to say, today is your day three. The stone has been rolled away. The curtain to the Holy of Holies has been ripped from top to bottom. He's not here. And you can have an encounter with an alive God. And you can once again, even with fear and joy, once again be excited because of what Jesus has done. He's no longer in the tomb. He's risen. Come and see. Maybe you don't believe in Jesus. Come and see. Maybe you're an atheist. Come and see. Maybe you're an agnostic. Come and see. Because he has the incredible power in the gospel that everyone that's tried to disprove that Jesus is risen has come to know him. And that every word that he speaks is true. And we need to grab hold of it. We need to know in our lives and in our hearts that he is risen. He is alive. And I serve him. Number one, he is risen. Number two, we see the work of grace when the stone was rolled away. That there was nothing that you and I could do. I didn't hang on the cross. I didn't go down to Sheol. I didn't walk out the tomb. It was all God. as the stone was rolled away by the angel, we see the work of grace taking place in our lives and in the world. There was nothing that you or I did. We didn't deserve life. In fact, we deserved death. We were indebted to the Heavenly Father. And all because of what Jesus did. Not me, not you. It was a work of grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. As the stone was rolled away, we were able to see grace because the body wasn't there anymore. He's not there. He's alive. Number three. There's the invitation to come and see, and I've shared that with you this morning. And part of the invitation that we've got to understand, in some of the Gospels, it talks about where the opening of the tomb was. You actually had to stoop down to look in. What I want to say to us in that stooping down, it's going beyond my thought process, it's going beyond my understanding, and coming to a place of surrender where I've accepted the invitation to look into the tomb and see for myself, not based on anyone else's words, not based on any pastor what they've said, but for myself, I've come to a place of surrender and I've come to a place of wanting to see that Jesus' body is not in the tomb, but see for myself that he's alive. And that invitation extends to all of us here in the room. It extends to the whole world. As I said to you, it doesn't matter what your position in religion is. Jesus' invitation to you is, if you don't believe me, come and see for yourself. If you don't think I'm alive, come and see for yourself. If you don't think I've made the heavens and the earth, come and see for yourself. If you don't think that I'm alive, come and see for yourself. Because until we've had that revelation and that encounter, all it is we're living out of a place of rules and regulations. Or we're living out of, can I say, our Sunday school stories. But Mary, on that day, encounters heaven through the angel and decided to stoop low and have a look in and see that there was just the cloth. And that invitation extends to us this morning, come and see. Come and see where the Savior lay. He's not there. He's alive. And then number four, the last thing that we learn is that on that day of encounter, we receive a new identity. And I was watching a video by Louis Giglio, and he puts it in this way, which was incredible. And I think this is very apt for what's taken place over the last while and where people sometimes find themselves. 2,000 years down the road, we don't see Jesus up in heaven, a victim. We don't see 2,000 years down the road, Jesus up in heaven going, well, guys, I'm sorry, I don't have time for you anymore because, you know, it was actually my beard that they plucked out. It was actually me that they put the spear in. It was actually me that they punched. So I'm sorry, I've got a couple of issues that I have to work through. You sort out yourself. And so often in life and all that's taken place, we pick up an identity of victim where we should be picking up the identity that Jesus bought for us on Calvary, which is a victor. Jesus is seated at the right-hand side of the Father, interceding for you and for me, and he sits there as a victor, not a victim. And that's the identity that has been bought for you on Calvary, that you are no longer a victim, you're a victor. And you can overcome any situation and circumstance that you find yourself if you would only come and see that he's no longer in the tomb. The stone has been rolled away. There's an opportunity to encounter the Savior, and we can live in a place of being victorious because of what he did on Calvary, and I don't have to play the role of victim, which the world so easily promotes nowadays. Woe is me, oh, this has happened. Oh, did you know that this happened over the last 2 years in my life? And I want to say, Jesus isn't sitting in heaven right now complaining about the crown of thorns that he had to wear for you and for me. He's not moaning in heaven right now about his beard being plucked out. He's not moaning about the nails in his hands, and those scars are still there. When we get to heaven, we will see the scars in his hands to show that it is him that died, was buried, was crucified, and he's risen again. Those scars are still in his hands. He's not sitting in heaven and complaining and moaning, but he has risen from the grave. He's seated victorious, and you and I have received that identity that we can be victorious in the day and age that we live in right now. I'm not a victim, I am a victor, and I don't have to be overcome by what the world is throwing at me. I can sit victorious, and I can say to the enemy, "Where, where?" You can. I see. Come on, come and see for yourself. Don't take it on my part. The enemy can throw the lockdown. The enemy can take away. But there's one thing that will never change, and that is the power that is found in the resurrection that took place 2,000 years ago. And the incredible thing that happens is that that resurrection power dwells not around us, but in you. And I don't have to be a victim anymore. You don't have to be a victim anymore. From this day, as you choose to encounter, come in humility and in surrender, and say, God, I want to encounter the real you. I want to encounter the resurrected power of Jesus. As you have that encounter, you walk out with a new identity that you're no longer a victim, but you're a victor. And that you can overcome anything that this world or the enemy may throw at you, because of what Jesus did for you on Calvary. And like the angel declared, come and see. I know who you seek. You seek Jesus. He's no longer here. He is risen. Come and see for yourself. And I want to, on that basis of either being in a place of despair, maybe being in a place of victim, I want to this morning break bread with you. I want us to break bread from this revelation that Jesus is no longer on the cross. The work of salvation has been done. God did it all. Let me say that again. God did it all. And the only thing that you and I have to actually do is just to come. We cannot rely on our own strength. We cannot rely on our own understanding. We cannot rely on our own plans. We've got to come back to a place. Mary arrived on the scene. As they arrived on the scene, encountered these guys who were dead on the floor, an angel sitting on the rock that was bright as stone. Didn't come up with some preconceived ideas, but they came and God, I've encountered, I trembled in the very presence of heaven. They didn't come up with another plan and say, oh, he's been stolen. They listened to the voice of heaven and began share the gospel of the good news that the Savior isn't on the cross, he isn't in the tomb, he's arisen and he's alive, and he has done everything he said he would do. And that resurrected power lives in you and me. So I want to break bread with you this morning. I'm going to ask some strapping young men, you know, Lucas, I said young, so that includes you, Even though Tony and... Yeah. So I'm going to ask you, can I ask them just to hand out the emblems? Thanks, Dennis. Thanks, Johan. Thanks, Gav. I think there's enough. Just check. to why they're handing out the emblems. Just, I want you just to take a moment and reflect on your life, and reflect where you are, reflect what's going on around you. And maybe to some degree, that darkness that fell on earth as Jesus hung there on the cross, maybe that's where you're at, where you feel a little bit despondent, in despair, uncertain, fearful, not sure what's going on around, and to some degree cannot see the Savior of the world in your life. Maybe to some degree you're a little bit anxious or uncertain of all that has taken place, and you haven't had that encounter with Jesus. Today is your day. Today is day 3, where I can say to you, He has truly risen and is alive. And if you would position your heart in humility and surrender and come before the throne room of grace, understand that that very resurrection power that raised Jesus from the dead can dwell in you if you would ask. Your day can be turned into night. Your fear can be turned, sorry, your night can be turned into day, sorry. Your fear can be turned into joy. Your bondage, the yoke that you may be carrying around today, can be lifted off your shoulders and an exchange can take place. Has everyone got, if you don't have, just quickly wave your hand so we can get these strapping young men. So won't you stand with me? And I want to share this good news with you this morning, that He's alive. That your spirit, your body, your soul would hear these words. He's not here, He's alive. He dwells in you. And He's here for you. And the invitation to come and see where He lay is here for you this morning. To come and check it out for yourself. To have that encounter and that fresh revelation. He's there for you, if you would only come. And so on that night, they took the bread. He blessed it and He said, thank you. We say thank you, Jesus, for your body that hung there on the cross for you, for me. Thank you that I didn't have to do anything. Thank you that I didn't have to go to the cross, but you went on my behalf and you took my sin, you took my shame, you took my debt, and you put it on your body and you hung it to the cross. And I say thank you for your body. Thank you because of what you did. I can become a part of your body. And that invitation to come and look, I've accepted, and I can walk in through the cross into the throne room boldly. And I thank you for your body in Jesus' name. And in the same manner, he took the cup. And we say thank you, Jesus, for your blood that was shed for the forgiveness of sin. That I'd be washed white as snow. I thank you for the blood that cuts a new covenant, where the veil has been torn from top to bottom. To allow the very presence of God out, and for the very power of God to dwell in me. That's the new covenant. And we thank you for your blood that was shed for the forgiveness of sin. We thank you for your innocent blood that was presented before the courtrooms of heaven. As you presented your blood, you said to your father, who was judge at that stage, and said, I've done all that you've asked for me. Your sons and daughters can now come home because the blood has been shed. And Jesus, we thank you for your blood that was shed for the forgiveness of my sins. In Jesus' name. So, Father, we thank you for this incredible story. Thank you that we can once again not just celebrate the risen Lamb of God today, but my encouragement is for you to share and be a part of the risen Lamb every day of your life, that you can celebrate His life tomorrow and Tuesday and for the rest of your life. As you ask Him into your life, as you ask to encounter Him, you can share in that resurrection power every day of your life and enjoy His life. So, Father, thank You for the Word. Thank You for the seed that has fallen on fertile soil. Thank You, Father, for all that You've done in our life today. Thank You, Father, for the invitation. And I pray, Father, that each one of us would accept that invitation to come and look. Not just where You lay and that You're no longer there, but also the invitation to come and look at what You're doing in Your kingdom every day. And we thank You for that. We accept that invitation and we want to walk in the resurrection power that comes because of what Jesus did. In Jesus' name. God bless. Have an incredible Sunday.